Hello, it's the 24th of February, and I'm speaking to Dr. Irene Caesar. Irene, please present yourself.
Hello, Viktoria, and thank you very much for having this interview and for being a distributor and representative of Genome.
Thank you.
I'm the founder, you're very welcome. The founder and the president of the American company Wave Genome LLC and Russian company Matrix City LLC. And my research is concerned with the quantum leap in genetics. This is a biotech company, startup biotech company. And what my company is doing is applying quantum physics to biology and genetics. And so far, no other company in the world has done this. So Wave Genome is the pioneer of recording bioholograms by lasers and transmitting these bioholograms, encoding these bioholograms into the chips on nano-level. And no other company had done this before, and no other company actually was a success of recording bioholograms, because all other researchers in the field, they either used wide-range electromagnetic recording via radio receiver like Peter Gariaev, which does not actually produce the proper hologram, or they use granular synthesis like my other scientist with whom I cooperated, Alexey Nikolaevich Diashov. So neither recording via radio receiver or granular synthesis via recording the holographic signal through the separate digital channels actually produce the wholesome biohologram. So as soon as you split biohologram into the separate digital channels, you destroy the biohologram. So this is the innovation that my company did. And how we solve this problem of preserving the systematic whole of the biohologram is by, first of all, recording the biohologram through the laser, which not simply has the internal mirrors as the stabilized helium neon lasers with internal mirrors that Peter Gariaev and Tertishny used. Not simply via any kind of electromagnetic induction coils, you see, like Luc Montagnier used, you see, or Nikola Tesla used. So coil or Lakovsky used, you see. So neither of these researchers, with due respect to Nikola Tesla, could have produced a biohologram via the coil. It is simply due to the coil being a certain generator of form. It's a form generator, shape generator. So geometrical shape of the coil and its physical qualities doesn't allow to produce the holographic signal. The coil functions as a amplifier of the signal. It actually stores the information in the form of the electromagnetic field, magnetic field. So it amplifies the electrical signal and stores the information in the form of the magnetic field. And it happens in the following way. Each turn of the coil actually overlays the wave upon itself. And when the wave is overlaid with itself multiple times, it actually increases the amplitude of the wave. So wave was like this, and it becomes like this, you see? And that's all, you see? And this amplification of the wave simply increases the field, you see? And in my theory, electrical field and magnetic field, they are not perpendicular to each other. I don't agree with this theory, you see? I consider magnetic field to be simply the stored electrical information. You see, in this, in some specific geometrical structures of the diffraction gratings of the superimposed waves. You see, so these are the information, the electrical information stored in the specific geometrical forms of the diffraction gratings of the superimposed waves. You see, and they are superimposed in the way of increasing the signal, the way I described right now, or nullifying the signal via the scalar wave. When the signal is reflected upon itself, and so it's reflected upon itself, right? It's backward going now, and the peak of the forward going wave is nullified by the trough of the same wave when it is reflected upon itself. You see? So these are the two basic principles of this wave superimposition. You see?
Okay.
And coil does not produce, you see, the holographic signal. And we use the laser that has the front producing the signals of the carrier and modulating wave. And this front, right, doesn't need a lens. So this is the laser without the lens. This is the innovative, newly invented Russian laser. And it doesn't have a lens. And even though it doesn't have a lens, it produces a more precise interference wave picture than the laser that has a lens, or the laser like Gareyev used with internal mirrors. And the point is that the whole procedure does not split the hologram into the separate digital signals, digital channels, in order to reconstruct the biohologram later. It actually records the biohologram upon the receiver in such a way that the interference, diffraction grating of waves seeks the signal through this interference diffraction grating grid. You see, so we create a grid that gets smaller and smaller. So each segment of the grid becomes itself a diffraction grating. And this creates a refraction. And the whole theory of refraction, it's my theory that I created in 1980s in Russia when I was a young girl like you.
How did you come up with this theory? What was the creative process and the research behind it?
So I was first, you see, much earlier than either Diashev or Galiaev or Tertishny or even Ahatin or Savelyev or anybody in this field who is doing diffraction gratings and lasers and bioholograms and anybody in the field, you see, at that point. And I have a manuscript written by my hand. And they were scanned by my business partner, Steve Schwartz, with whom I am finishing right now the book, which has the code name Wave Pharmaceuticals. And he scanned these pages. So the manuscript written by my hand in 1980s. And it has diagrams and vortices and wave pictures. And the sense of my theory is that the universe is holographic, meaning that it isn't entirely in its every matrix point. And matrix point is my term. I was first formulated this term. Now it's widely used after I introduced it to the scientific community. And matrix point specifically means that it contains the entire universe inside itself. And because the universe is holographic, we can record and transmit only holographic information. And this holographic information exists in the form of wave crystals. So wave crystal sounds like no scientific term, but it's a very scientific term. It's much more scientific term than anything that is right now conventionally accepted in the academia by Nobel laureates in genetics. It's much more scientific than exons and introns and transcription and translation, which are very vague terms. You see, they are metaphors in comparison with the wave crystal. Wave crystal means that there is a crystalline structure which is made by the crystalline grid of waves. So it is a crystal made of waves. That's why it's called wave crystal. And holograms, they exist specifically in these wave crystals. So let me just hold on. You can just tune it. Just hold on. Which is a city phone. I could not turn it off. It's a city phone. So we just you will just switch it later. So you turned it on, right?
Yes.
So holograms exist in the form of wave crystals. And what does this mean? So we should understand what this means. And this means that crystal is a specific geometrical optical structure.
Right.
And it is the optics of waves. Not simply geometrical optics, wave optics. It's a physical phenomenon. And it is based upon the fact that glass lets the signal through, and crystal doesn't let the signal through. It actually refracts the signal towards the center, the focus of the crystal. This is the difference between glass and crystal. So crystal actually, you might say, collects energy and transforms energy. That's why if you have a diamond ring, right, it shines. It shines not simply because it reflects light, but it actually collects and increases the light signal in its zero center, which is a term of quantum physics. And it increases this signal and changes its nature due to the wave optics in the crystal media. And our bodies are liquid crystal media. So you cannot explain any genetic processes, any biological, cellular, molecular processes without explaining a wave or explaining wave crystals. So wave crystals in the liquid crystal media of our cells and molecules is the foundation of genetics. And if genetics doesn't deal with this issue, it is simply fake science, pseudoscience, which disinforms, you see, audience, investors, and simply launders money and wastes our resources. So we should explain wave crystals. And in 1980s, I created the theory of wave crystals. And this theory consisted of three major statements. The first statement is there is the negative cover around the wave crystal, which actually creates its manifestation in a specific environment. And this negative cover is created by the change of the spin, in this integral torsion. So there are no particles. You see, nobody saw electrons, and nobody would actually see electrons. Nobody saw photons. You see, these are all fictions. We only have the integral torsion, and when it changes the spin, it creates the illusion of a particle. That's all. And this electron you might say encapsulation of the atom, right? It's simply the change of the spin. And this negative cover encapsulation doesn't allow the signal to go through. It actually reflects the signal upon itself. And when the signal is reflected upon itself, we get the scalar wave diffraction grating, which literally crystalline structure, a grid. And it actually goes smaller, smaller, and smaller. And each segment of the grid creates its own scalar wave diffraction grating. So scalar wave is scaled from the planetary to biosphere to the body organism to the tissue, organ, bodily organ, physiological system, to the cellular level, molecular level, atomic level, and subatomic level. You see, it's the same non-local wave matrix. And this is not formulated by anybody else, you see. So scalar wave is scaled. And because it is scaled, it actually refracts the signal due to the simple electrical processes of, you see, the same charge, you see, repelling each other and opposite charge attracting each other. So it's everything is simple enough, you see. So it actually pushes the signal, refracts the signal towards the zero center, the focus of this wave crystal. And these are the two second statements, right? So the first statement is that the wave crystal or matrix or hologram or ADIS, it has the negative color. Second, it reflects the signal upon itself. And third, it refracts the signal towards the zero center of the structure. So these are the three principles that I formulated when I was 20-something years old in Russia. So I actually understood this principle much earlier than anybody even in Russia, which much more advanced than the West in this sense, even started working with holograms and diffraction gratings and lasers and bioholography and polarized holography and anything you can call it with. And I applied this theory to chromosomes in 2010 when I simply started my business in biotechnology. And in 2013 and 2014, I have already formulated a very coherent theory of wave crystals and wave optics or geometrical wave optics in chromosomes. The same gene gets expressed in dysfunctional individuals and species via the acrocentric chromosome, which is a geometrical shape of wave structures, you see, superimposed waves that is similar to the dysfunctional eye, myopic, nearsighted or farsighted eye. It simply doesn't have a focus. You see the zero center in its wave crystal. It looks like this. It is asymmetrical. And the same gene gets expressed in functional species and individuals via the metacentric chromosome, which is similar to the well-functioning eye, which has a perfect focus, zero center of its crystal. You see, we'll see it because we have a crystal, you see, in our eye. And this crystal actually gathers all the infinite signals and bombards us, you see. It gathers it within this focus, you see. And it actually changes its shape. And due to the change in this shape, it can actually see different things, you see, because we can see the infinite number of things. If we shape our eye in a specific way, we can see things that are not actually even visible to the physical eye, you see, and we actually do. We simply conventionally reject this fact, but it's true. And it's not only humans, it's true for the animals and insects and even everything is actually interconnected in this way. Because everything, every matrix point has this wave crystal. So information gets collected in some matrix point. And these are the actually, you might say, storages or entries to the library of the infinite information, eternal and infinite information. So the eye changes its shape. It can change such its shape, its shape in such a way that it sees a thing close to itself. And when it sees a thing close to itself, things that are far away are blurred, right? But when it changes its shape in another way, right, it's crystal, it can see things that are far away. And when it's, our eye sees the things that are far away, the things that are close to us are blurred.
Right.
So this is precisely how chromosome functions. You see, we can change the shape of our chromosome in such a way that we can stop being human, we will become a virus. So we can become literally the parts of the planetary organism of a virus, because every virus and bacteria is a planetary organism. It's a wave crystal, and there is nothing metaphorical in this, you see? So protein translation and gene transcription, RNA, you know, the transcription, all process connection to RNA, these are metaphors, you see? But this, the non-locality of wave matrix, is a physical fact. It's a simply a reality expressed in a very precise term. And when we change our chromosome to become a virus, we simply get sick and die. And we literally become a part of this planetary virus. So the point is how to actually control the shape of our chromosome as a liquid media crystal, which is in reality wave crystal. And the other point in my theory is that the universe is holographic, yes, but also the universe is 93% energy and only 8% particles, you see, and even particles concentrated energy. And I remember even how I first heard this statement. I heard this statement from Inga Swan, who was a psychic working for the United States intelligence agencies in the remote viewing experiments. And here is the guy who stated, for example, that Russia is much ahead than, or this was much ahead of the United States in all this quantum leap science. And he was clearly stating that for him it was the revelation of his life when he read in the United States major science magazine, Nature, this fact that the universe is 93% energy and only 8% particles. And these particles are simply the concentrated energy. And it actually corresponds to the 2% of our DNA, which is understood, you see, for protein creation, for creation of proteins, you see, transcription of proteins. They call it coding DNA, right? And 98% of DNA is not understood. It's called junk DNA. But it is precisely those 92%, which is the wave crystals of energy, that cannot be explained via the paradigm of coding proteins, you see? So if geneticists are concentrated on coding proteins, they would never explain 92% of DNA, you see? And this is ridiculous because they literally explain the consequences of the major mechanism in genetics, you see? And calling the major mechanism of genetics junk, you see? This is just ridiculous. So they, by this, they actually expose themselves as junkies. So I would call any geneticist who calls the 92% of DNA, which are the major process in DNA, junk DNA, I would call the geneticist a junkie. A junkie geneticists, you see, geneticists. And the same is true of our brain. Only 5% of our brain is explained, you see. And this is precisely because of this. So any scientist who would do brain mapping, and this is precisely what all the intelligence agencies are doing right now, they are brain mapping. And they're trying to connect brain mapping with DNA mapping with the global artificial intellect mapping, and the goal is to patent an embryo, to sterilize humans all over the world, to patent an embryo and to sell to humans their babies, artificially made. The same way as Monsanto is selling seeds of the sterile corn all over the world. So this is their goal, you see? So we should be very clear what we are doing, why we are doing, what are the consequences of what we are doing, because we have very little time left, because they would actually attempt of sterilizing the humanity. They are getting closer and closer to this point. And when they will sterilize humanity, we will get the picture presented in the movie Blade Runner 2049. Did you see the movie? So the movie, I would advise, I stopped watching Hollywood movies a while ago, but I made an exception for this movie. This movie presents the world of the after nuclear war destroyed, and this nuclear war was also the cyber war, which erased all the digital data from any data storage facilities, any data storage devices, from any computer, tablets, iPad, phone, hard drive, flash drive, cloud, you see? So it erased all the information. So literally transformed the world into the ground zero in any sense. And the third thing that happened, sterilization of humans. And those humans who were sterilized, they are not considered to be humans anymore. They transformed to the slaves. Because they said, you are not human, you can't reproduce, you see? And these humans that are not capable to reproduce, they implanted with all kinds of chips, brain chips, liquid crystal chips that DARPA reported about in 2014, they implanted in with all kinds of nanobots and etc. etc. Yes, brain, yes. Computer interface, BCI, and so on. So the intrigue of the movie consists in the sudden miracle that occurs, that one of these degraded humans, destroyed humans, are actually capable of getting a baby. You see, conceiving a baby, giving a birth. So this creates the possibility for them to become wholesome, to become matrix points again. So what's right now going on in the West is their preparation for the final point of sterilization of humans. And in the United States, in the Western Europe, including all the developed capitalist countries like Great Britain, Germany, France, Italy, Australia, Canada, United States, we have the production of genetically modified food. And it is said that as soon as the country not simply consumes genetically modified food, but produces the genetically modified food, there is no turning back, because the genetically modified food creates the contamination of the environment, pollution. So this genetically destroyed waste matrices, right, they get distributed via ground waters, via pollen, via insects, via manure, you know, animal manure of the agricultural animals, and so on. And it actually destroys the environment. And there is a scientist in Russia, Irina Ermakova, and there are many scientists who actually dealt with this problem, and they were all persecuted in the West. And Irina Ermakova, she conducted experiments with mice, and with mice, and she found out that if a female a mouse is fed with a genetically modified soy, she will become sterile, her offspring will become sterile in the third generation. But if both the female and male mice are fed up with their genetically modified soy, the offspring becomes sterile in the second generation. And if you add to this all other kinds of sterilization through vaccines, through psychotronic trials on civilians worldwide, and through the wide use of the distilled water, reverse osmosis, which you completely eliminates the crystallized structure of water, which is as dangerous as GMO, in fact. And if you add to this all kinds of other genetic weapons, biological binary weapons that are used right now in the West, and the spreading of nanobots and organic matter genetically modified in such a way that it is united with silicon for producing cyborgs, you see, and it spreads from the planes, the chemtrails. You see, if you take this all, you see that the West right now is in the state of the genetic collapse.
So what can we do?
And in 5 years from now, 10 years from now, there will be no healthy child born in the United States and no any children born in the United States. You see? And the war will be for the children, you see, because they will find out the synthetic embryos will be not good, the same way as genetically modified food is not good. You see, it's the way to destruction. And at some point, it will be clear that it is not possible to acquire immortality by becoming a swarm of nanobots in the computer, you see, as Ray Kurzweil wants. He is a patient of the psychiatric clinic, you see. And every investor who invested in Ray Kurzweil, including Google Corporation, are simply patients of the psychiatric clinic, you see. So I wish them all become swarms of nanobots, you see, in the computer. And what we should do right now, we should stop it, because otherwise we will simply destroy this planet. There will be no survivors, you see. It will be other global war than it was 16,000 years BC, the last global war between giants of megalithic civilization. This war, the coming war, will be another war. It literally might destroy this civilization and the life, entire life on this planet. Because we are talking not about civilization of only civilization of humans. We are talking about civilization of plants, civilization of insects, civilization of animals, you see? And destruction of the electromagnetic fields of this planet by heart. So all change of climate is linked only to the heart, to microwaving the ionosphere. So bombard ionosphere, attempting to move atmospheric fronts to manipulate the weather. So the only way of how we can stop the genetic collapse is, first of all, we should preserve what is not destroyed yet. Because we are coming to the point when everything will be destroyed and there will be no matrix points. So we are talking not human, because we are not human. So when they are speaking about transhumanism, posthumanism, it's so acquiring digital immortality, it's so stupid, because we are already eternal. We are already infinite. We are already we are not created, not indestructible. We are matrix points, and what we are talking about is preservation of matrix points in this dimension. And if matrix points will be destroyed, this dimension will be destroyed. So we should create the library of the matrix points, matrices, for every, like tokens, for this non-local matrices to enter this dimension. You understand? So they are non-local. They are infinite from the infinitely large to the infinitely small dimension. And matrix points are teleportation portals, you might call them. They are points of entry into this dimension. We should preserve these points of entry. And we should record these wave matrices via the devices that are capable of recording these wave matrices, digitizing these wave matrices, and creating a kind of the library of the digital seeds of life, so that we can turn back the destruction. So this is practical magic, you might call it, because we can actually control the 8% of reality particles via this 92% of energy. If you know the way of how to use this energy. And very important point to understand this theory is to understand the implication of the holographic principle, which I formulated in 2012, in August. And holographic principle states that the universe is entirely in its every matrix point. And the implication of the holographic principle states that if the universe is entirely in its every matrix point, it means that every matrix point is not simply different from any other matrix point, but is unique. So every matrix point is a non-local infinite. It's its own non-local infinity, parallel dimension. So matrix points, they exist in parallel dimensions. And each one of wave matrices is both non-local and unique. And if you have two exact copies of the same non-local wave matrix, non-local, unique wave matrix, you can transmit information instantaneously from one copy of the same non-local unique matrix to another copy, because they constitute, in this quantum non-locality, they constitute the integral, the systematic whole. They are the same, basically. So this is an illusion that they are different, but in reality, they are one and the same, non-local unique wave matrix. And to transmit information between parallel dimensions, because you and me, we each one of us are its own, or your own unique non-local wave matrix. And to transmit morphological information between both of us, we need an additional structural code. And this structural code would allow us to exchange morphological information. Otherwise, we are completely self-sufficient and completely independent and completely protected. So this is self-protection of the universe from destruction. And the experiments were done for both modes. The first mode, the transmission, instantaneous transmission, remote transmission of information between two copies of the same unique non-local wave matrix was done in 1999 by the Institute for National Security, it was called later, but at the moment it was called BINAR Institute, the offshoot of the Institute Energy in Soviet Russia, which was founded in 1937 with 5,000 scientists, the most secret KGB Institute, and they conducted the official experiment for lowering blood sugar in the diabetic cup in the distance of 20 kilometers via the remote laser signal in 1999, before Peter Garey, who did similar thing in Toronto in 2002 with Tishney. And they transmitted the insulin by laser upon the photograph of the cuff. And the cuff was located 20 kilometers from the place of the laser, and it was done for the American Diabetic Association, officially, publicly. So the instantaneous transmission of information was experimentally proven. So this theory, right, is empirically proven. And this, and I call this wave transmission the holonet of the first degree, the holographic internet or the quantum by internet, but it's holographic internet, that's why I call it holonet, and nobody used this term before me. I made this term public in 2015 with Magnus Olsen, and since then it's used already by some people, but I was first who used this term, holonet, holographic internet, of the first degree. And I call the second wave of transmission remote instantaneous transmission of information between two parallel dimensions, I call it the holonet of the second degree, when we transmit information from one unique non-local wave matrix to the other unique non-local wave matrix. For example, transmission of information between the rabbit and the goat. Evidently, they can't have sex and have babies, right? So you can't get a rabbit with the goat's horns, and you can get baby goat with the rabbit ears, right? So Russians in the 1970s, in the Kurchat of aerospace, outer space, cosmonautics, Institute near Moscow, Center, Aeronautical Center near Moscow, they conducted an experiment transmitting morphological information, which was a success, from pregnant goat to pregnant rabbit and from pregnant rabbit to pregnant goat. They put pregnant rabbit and pregnant goat in the same, exactly the same calibrated convex copper lenses. And as a result, pregnant goat gave birth to a little goat with big rabbit ears, and pregnant rabbit gave birth to a rabbit with goat's horns. So Russians were successful of transmitting morphological information, which you cannot transmit in any other way. So the wave transmission was through the structural phantom, and the wave crystals, they function through the refraction codes. So when you change the shape of the crystal of your eye, you in fact change the refraction code. So if you have two unique, different unique non-local wave matrices, you can transmit information from one matrix to another matrix only through this structural phantom, which is a special refraction code, which is added as a modulating wave to the scale wave diffraction grating to slightly manipulate the refraction inside the wave crystal. And what my company does, my company produces lenses which help our chromosomes change refraction codes. So you can actually change refraction codes in such a way that you can actually like an ideal, right? Destroy through your chromosome the planetary virus, you see? So if you will be connected in such a way, you see, to the universal noosphere, this infinite storage of information and energy, you can actually change the refraction code of your chromosome in such a way that you can destroy planetary virus. So this is what true immortality is. And true power is not the stupid, idiotic fantasies of impotent Ray Kurzweil, and Elon Musk, and Peter Thiel. And the other point which is bothering me is that the elites, unfortunately, they have access to material wealth, to resources, unlimited resources. They collected, you might say, unlimited material wealth. But they degraded their genetics to such a way that they similarly are evolutionarily returned to Neanderthal stage. So Satanism is literally the mechanism of transforming Cro-Magnons or humans, proper humans, right, into the Neanderthals. And after the last global war, 14,000, 16,000 BC, there was a global flood because the axis moved of the Earth, and this was the high-tech global war described in the Vedas with the use of the plasma, nuclear, gravitational, psychotronic plasma weapons. People went into the underground cities, and our planet is a vast network of the underground cities. And they came out to the surface approximately 10,000 BC, Paleolithic age. And they destroyed this civilization in the polar areas of Russia, precisely because the ionosphere above the North Pole has this perfect convex lens form, right? The form of the cupola, and the pyramidal part of the cupola amplifies the signal the way I described in the beginning of our interview. The same wave gets superimposed upon itself, and the amplitude increases. And in the spherical part of the cupola, the wave is reflected upon itself, and this creates the scalar wave diffraction grating, scalar wave, the diffraction grating, and diffraction. So North Pole creates the conditions for the superintelligence. That's why birds are flying to the North Pole to hatch their eggs, so they can do it in the South, right? So they instinctively know that the North Pole has the condition for the superintelligence, and this is also due to the 6 months polar day, so-called day of the gods in the Vedas, which goes uninterruptedly for 6 months. So you need strong, continuous signal. So the diffraction grating gets smaller, 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 so that the focuses are more precise for diffraction, right? And our mothers, it was matriarchal socialism, they restored civilization in the polar areas of Russia. And there was the interglacial period, 7000 BC, and winter temperatures didn't fall down the winter temperatures in Greece. And when it became colder, they went to the south in all directions, coming to Indostan. It was the first wave of Russian aliens coming to Indostan. And etc. etc. So they came to the equatorial areas of this planet, and they saw Neanderthals because there is a well-known physical phenomenon when the two torsions, one coming from the South Pole and another one descending from the North Pole, they nullify each other in the scalar wave grating, and there are electromagnetic anomaly on the equator. So equator is a dangerous way, a place to live. I would never advise anybody to live by the equator. It's very dangerous. You can lose your mind. So people literally go into trance and stupor. So they saw Hanuman in India. Hanuman is a Neanderthal. And if you see Hanuman description, depiction in India, you see a man with a monkey jaw. So it's a half monkey, half man. And they married Hanuman, they married Neanderthals in Sumer, in Iraq, and they married Hanuman in India, and they brought them up. And when they brought them up, right, and taught them mythology that they created, Bronze Age and Urals, they tamed all animals, including monkeys and cats and geese and chickens and cats and dogs and cows, even tried to tame lions, and took the weapons and architecture, etc., etc. They struck back at some point. And when they struck back, it was when the Upper Egypt, the Ethiopian and North Sudan, conquered the Lower Egypt, which was purely Russian area. The same happened in Indostan, the same period. And the Neanderthals, they brought with themselves their own Neanderthal culture, which consisted in cannibalism and pedophilia. And these were considered always in our culture as karmic crimes. So when a person commits human sacrifice and pedophilia, he becomes a Neanderthal. He stops being a matrix point. His mind becomes dark. He cannot have a clear vision. He cannot understand simple things like Ray Kurzweil. He wants to be a swimmer now, not nanobots in the computer. So only a person with a completely darkened mind can actually think of these kind of things. And right now, this Neanderthal tradition is still preserved in the West. So in Russia, it was never dominant. Russia remained this matriarchal culture. Socialism is simply the rudiments of the matriarchal socialism, so-called clan society, which was called primitive by Marx, but it's not primitive at all. And what is bothering me, right, is that right now this cannibalism acquires the scientific form. So before it was marginal satanic practices, right? So they were gathering in dark places, stealing infants and pierce the infant in specific places. They drained the blood, they dried the blood, they made powder, they added this powder to their bread and whatever, just be drinking blood. Like Satanists directly, but this was considered marginal, but even by themselves. But right now, the cannibalism acquires the scientific form. For example, Peter Thiel, the member of the steering committee of the Bilderberg Club, the man who is at the forefront of the scientific research in the United States of America, forepost of freedom and democracy, right, in the world. The most progressive culture, you see? The flagmanship of the humanity, right? The guy, the major guy of the United States, responsible for science, he takes blood from the teenager and injects this blood into his own body for rejuvenation. Meanwhile, there is the Irene. Invented or discovered by Mellor, Craig Mellor and Craig Fire in 1998, in which they got the Nobel Prize in 2006. RNA interference. They researched S. elegans worm. So I'm telling this to actually add to the picture of the genetic collapse, you see? So genetically modified food is not even the most horrible thing that it's on the plate right now. So they researched S. elegans worm. It's a worm. They took the genetic material from the worm and injected it back. And this shut down worm's genetics. So this says that all Satanists who drink human blood, they literally shut down their DNA. And this explains why so-called Jews, right? Because they are Russian by blood, I don't know why they're called Jews. But if they take their human blood for so long, right, why? They have so many genetic diseases. So they have so many genetic diseases precisely because of this. So RNA interference is the major binary biological weapon which can be added to food like Coca-Cola, for example. Snippets of RNA, short RNA, double-stranded RNA can be added into food like Coca-Cola, for example, or McDonald's burgers, right? And can be distributed all over the world, shutting down genetics, right, of humanity, sterilizing. So you can sterilize the entire humanity much faster than just selling Monsanto babies. They want Monsanto babies. So we have the urgency. We have the urgency because we have this weapon against humanity as RNA interference, which is sold right now to us as CRISPR by Jennifer Doudna, who made into the front man of the coming zombie apocalypse in the United States. Because these people, they don't simply want civilization. They want such a civilization that this would be force majeure to nullify, to wipe away United States debt to other countries, right? To Saudi Arabia, China, Russia, etc., Japan, who store their, who buy United States treasuries. So to wipe away the debt and to wipe away excess population, to make it easier to control digitally global population, and to require assets, hard assets. So literally to rob the global population. So for this organized crime, which calls itself Synagogue of Satan, they call it themselves, they want civilization in the form of force majeure and RNA interference sold to the public, global public, as CRISPR-Cas9 genetic engineering, create this opportunity of force majeure to actually creating some kind of catastrophe, genetic collapse catastrophe. Not simply, you understand me, not simply the slow boiling of the frog. So when you slowly boil the frog, slowly, gradually, the frog doesn't understand that it's getting boiled, and it's actually getting boiled for sure. But these people, they don't want to wait. They want it fast. So we have the urgency that we have this dangerous weapon of the RNA interference. And we have also the elites who destroy the genetics via these Neanderthal practices. They are scientifically proven to be destructive to genetics. So we can only hope that in the United States, some military were not introduced yet to blood sacrifice, not yet tried human blood. So we can only hope that in the United States, in France, in Germany, in the United States, in Canada, there are people who didn't try drinking human blood yet. How is wonderful that! So, and these people who are not introduced here to karmic crime like this, they should urgently create the library of digitized bio-holograms of still healthy children and plants and animals and insects. Because what they're doing, they try to control not only plants, they're trying to control insects, for example, mosquitoes. Rockefeller Institute is trying to control mosquitoes, so a mosquito would deliver the artificially created Zika virus by Rockefeller Institute to a specific racial group, a specific individual. This is what they're doing right now.
I'd like to ask about individual generation that we have our photograph, because the highest frequency we can get is the one we were born with.
Did you hear what?
Yeah, the sound. Sorry. Can't hear myself. About the individual Tesla generator, we have to send our childhood photograph. Is it because the highest frequency we can get in this lifetime is the frequency we were born with?
Wait, connection. Sorry. Can you repeat? Sorry, very bad connection.
Yes.
Yes.
About the individual Tesla generators. Is it that we have to send our childhood photograph because the frequency we were born with in this lifetime is the highest frequency we can get again when we are grown ups?
Well, we use the childhood photograph because children, they come from adult life. And they come through the zero center of the waste crystal of this planet. And this zero center of our planet, of the crystal, waste crystal of our planet, coincides with the zero center of the waste crystal of the solar system, which is the sun. That's why all the solar symbolic swastikas, etc. And this zero center coincides with the zero center of our galaxy and our universe. And they coming from the absolute light. And no evil reptilia can actually get to this zero center. So all people who speak about evil reptilia coming to this dimension, they simply are ignorant. And also patients of the psychiatric clinic. Because no evil can come through the zero center because it's the absolute concentration of the absolute light. And absolute light is called Ra. So Russians are those who come from the absolute light, Ra. And our major river, Volga, was called Ra. And Ros, Russia, Ros, Os is simply the Hellenistic suffix. But in reality, it's Ra. And all humans on this planet are Russians. Proper humans, Kramyons. And children come from this absolute light. And in fact, animals and insects and plants, they also come through this matrix point, but they share collectively for the genus, the matrix point. But humans have this matrix point individually. And we record the holograms from the child photograph because the weight matrix of this human, which is undestructed and uncreated, indestructible and uncreated, is most preserved on the childhood photograph. And if human is born with genetic defects, we can correct this genetic defect in the biohologram because we have a template. That's why it is important, you see, to have a template. So when George Church from Harvard University is speaking about creation of the synthetic embryo, what he's talking is in fact, is trying to record the biohologram of the child, of the embryo, and patent it. It's ridiculous. It's unbelievable, actually. But the way he is doing it is completely, totally destructive. And even by desire to patent the human embryo, he violates the unconditional freedom of the, every human as a matrix point. So it's a complete violation of any foundation of human freedom and democracy written in the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights, any international law and any Geneva Convention. So the guy is simply worse than any Nazi criminal who was used in the Nuremberg process. So the guy is simply criminal. So you cannot impose upon humans some synthetic embryo with some guy from Harvard who is who is apologetic of genetically modified food, right? And who doesn't even eat himself genetically. I would argue that Knight, Doudna, or Church from Harvard, Doudna from Berkeley, and Church from Harvard eat GMO. But they want to impose upon us GMO and want to impose upon us genetically modified synthetic embryos. And George actually wants to introduce pig genes into human embryos. So that's why even collection of photographs, of images of humans will be precious. That's why they want cyber hit. You see? So why civilization of humans and global cyber war, cyber hit, are important for this global organized crime syndicates, all of us, synagogue of Satan, or mother lodge of London. Why cyber hit is important for them? It's important to erase the images of humans. They want to even erase the images because if you have an image of a healthy child, you can record the biohologram of the child, of the matrix point from this photograph.
Could you please talk about the clinical trials that you have been carrying out?
Well, I developed a new protocol for recording biohograms via the laser without the lens, which with wide wavefront of carry wave, a modulating wave. And this laser was never yet before used for recording biohologram. So it was the first use of this laser for this laser for recording the bioholograms. And the digitizing of these bioholograms was done by the same scientist at the Bauman State University of Russia, the major and most important science university of Russia, of MIT level. So, done by scientists who did the creation of mathematical model of the trajectories for the newly invented top rocket, Kalibr, medium-range missile, top Russian missile. And the reason for doing this was simply to raise the production of my company to the other level, to conduct a clinical trial, to use the most advanced laser, and to use the most advanced digital models of digitizing, verifiable models of digitizing, of laser recording and the clinical trials. So, with this experiment, verification experiment, my company met the Western standards of research and development biotech startup. So you might say that my company right now have proven all the statements that were done by me, that we are capable of recording by holograms, we are capable of digitizing these holograms, and we are capable of administering this by hologram, verifiable by clinical trials. And we have chosen two bioholograms. The first biohologram was from the preparation similar or analogous to aspirin. And I call it aspirin, holographic aspirin. And we have chosen, I and my group of scientists, whom I fully funded myself, and who simply realized my theoretical model. So I gave them the whole theoretical apparatus. So they didn't speak the language of holograms and refraction, scalar wave diffraction gating. So I literally guided them, introduced to them the theoretical apparatus. I introduced to them the technological model I would like to realize, and these scientists simply realized what my company needed at that moment. And the scientists included the Alexander Kuzmich Volkov. He is the head of the Medical and Technology Center at the Bauman State University. He is a full professor and PhD medical scientist. And Dr. Vladimir Yevgeny Sinopanikov, who is his vice chair, so Dr. Volkov is the chair of the medical center, technological center, educational center, and Dr. Snopanikov is the vice chair. And they both teach at the Bauman State University. And Dr. Snopanikov is also the renowned doctor of Russian Federation, which is a very exclusive rank of honor. And also he was a doctor, physician who was responsible for the aeronautics program, outer space program in Russia. So he was working on this project. And we used the lasers of the Bauman State University. And the sense of this Hasperian was that it was easy to verify. So aspirin, preparation similar to aspirin, they influence blood in such a way that you can actually verify this with the test. So they are anticoagulant preparations, and they thin the blood, in other words. And their experiment consisted in finding, first of all, the proper preparation of something close to aspirin, and verifying this preparation in a specific way. And we used not simply the solid pill, we used the suspension, the water suspension of a pill in this dispersed state, which is also very important technology never used by anybody else. You see, people use water. And many, even very close to Vatican scientists in Italy, use water because it's so obvious. Because Jesus Christ and Church, they use water, you see, for the ritual, for the process of transferring some energy through water. It's obvious, especially to people who are deeply religious. But nobody used water in dispersed state, the sprinkling state. And simply because, maybe because the church in the West is a derivative kind of church, is a later form of the Christianity. And in Russian Orthodox Christianity, this very ancient Russian Aryan beliefs, cupolas and bells, and using water in dispersed state when they have sprinkled, you see, sprinkled the people who come to the church. So we use this dispersed state to actually verify and record the biohologram. And we use different ways, not only lasers. We use also other kind of interference wave structures that can be created via different methods, not only by lasers. And we also used recording in different kind of spectra, and in such spectra which have the carrier wave and modulating wave. First we found the preparation, and second we recorded the biohologram of this preparation, and we digitized the biohologram. And when you digitize the biohologram, you can administer this hologram in three ways. You can use this digitized biohologram in the digital pharmacy, in binaural therapy, when you use your skull as a cupola, as a convex lens, with one signal delayed in one ear, and you can create in your skull this scalar wave diffraction grating, and right in the middle of your skull you have a liquid crystal which is literally a zero center of this wave crystal. And we actually think, not only because we have some substance in our brain, but because we have the shape of the skull. And if you would have a shape which is you know, like half of my forehead, I would actually be not that smart, unfortunately. That's why our ancestors, they were prolongating the skulls. And it's actually shown by the artifacts found in the Bronze Age mummies in archive with R1A1 DNA. The humans, tall, very tall humans, descendants from the antediluvian giants with very prolongated skull, much higher than mine, like at least twice higher. So you can deliver the digitized biohologram in the digital pharmacy. You can deliver digitized hologram encoded onto the chip by laser. And for doing this, you need to use the electrode-based chip. And the sense of electrodes is that electrodes, they store the crystalline structures within the electrode. And if you bombard this electrode with the external signal, the electrode actually releases this crystalline structure upon the environment. And this is used by the church, for example, in wax candles. So wax candles, all these sacred resins like frankincense and myrrh, and etc., they actually use this ability of electrodes to store this wave matrices of ritual, which is conducted above this wax when it is liquid. So you can actually imprint your wave matrix upon the wax, and then when it becomes solid, it actually stores this wave matrix. And when it burns, when you light it up and it burns, it actually releases this wave matrix upon the environment, close range environment. So this is the quality of electrodes, and they can be artificial or they can be organic. So in our second generation chips, we use organic electrodes. And in the first generation chips, we use synthetic electrodes. And you can use, for example, 3D printing plastic, or you can use other kind of electrode substances to imprint their wave matrix upon electrode. You simply need to create a specific environment. And this environment precisely consists in creating the set of convex lenses and controlled is a closed kind of environment, which is representative, for example, in our life-size generators. So you need to some kind of this life-size, small size of this life-size, as we use generators, to be capable of transforming linear signal into the holographic signal. And this was first, by the way, noticed by Николай Козырев, when he, after the war in 1948, in the Crimea Observatory, he was an astrophysicist, and he put yeast into the convex lens of the telescope, and he noticed that the signal from the stars actually influences the yeast when it is placed in the convex lens of the telescope. By the way, he noticed the other thing. He noticed that there is the delay of signal, right? Because the so-called speed of light, right? Visible light. He was first to notice that there are two kinds of light. One light is the physical light, visible light, that is delayed. And another one is not visible light, which is instantaneous. He was the first scientist who actually was proven or had proven that there are two kinds of light. And this light, the second light, I call it the light that does not cast a shadow. You see, Egyptians, they called it black light, dark light. So it's a light even in complete darkness, you see. So it's not visible, it is not the visible light. And yeast was responsive, it was responding specifically to this light from the stars, instantaneous light, which is independent of time and space, which goes straight through quantum nullability, if between parallel realities, parallel dimensions, if you have a key, structural key, refraction key, structural phantom, which opens the door between dimensions, and this structural key is the sacred geometry of our ancestors, and this shape, X-shape structures, they can be either X-shaped or shape of the our churches, cupolas, or our helmets of our ancestors. And there was the scientist Barchenko in Russia, who before the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917, he has proven that these helmets of our ancestors increase the telepathic abilities, the abilities of clear vision. So our ancestors on the war field, they actually used these helmets for their instantaneous transmission of information between each other. So if the information was transmitted exactly because each one of them had the helmet made according to the same refraction code, you see? So they had the key of transmission between each other. And the same is true of Russian Orthodox churches. So the whole territory was covered by this grid of churches, which were had the cupolas like the helmets of our ancestors. So the information transmitted in one church was amplified by the grid of these churches, and amplified not simply in the quantitative way. It's actually was making the focus, the zero center of the wave crystal, more precise, more clear. And that's why you should live in the cupola dwellings, with the cupola ceilings. Our ancestors were living in the cupola houses. Not simply churches with cupola. They lived in a cupola. My dream is to build a cupola house. Because if you live in a cupola house, the energy in the rectangular house is distributed right below the ceiling. But in the, if you live in the cupola house, you literally are conducting practical magic. So you're literally putting your desire into directly, instantaneously into the universal ionosphere, noosphere. So we used these different various methods to encode that aspirin upon the chip. So you can distribute aspirin, holographic aspirin, via digital pharmacy, via the chip. And the third way, you can simply send the remote laser signal at long range. If you have the key between parallel dimensions, because all humans, they exist on this planet, each one of them in his or her own parallel dimension. And you need a structural key. The same way as our ancestors, they had this helmet, which had specifically sacred proportion, which was preserved from generation to generation through millennia. So it was the most sacred secret, you see, that they preserved, so that it allowed them to transmit information between dimensions, from the past to the future, to the other planets, to the dead, to from alive and from alive to the dead, from dead to the life. That's why what this organized crime syndicate is doing, they try to destroy our sacred symbols, for example, swastika, which is opposed to Nazism and racism. It is the symbol of global equality, fraternity, and freedom. It's the symbol of as above, as below. It's the turning solar cross and sun, this absolute sun, not physical sun, absolute light, Ra. It gives light equally, light equally to everybody, independently of race, nationality, gender, education, caste, and even transgression. And preserving this weak matrices of humans should go together with preserving the structural keys that would help us to restore those horrible damage that is inflicted by this organized crime syndicate. And we use this holographic aspirin on the group of patients, and the clinical trials have shown that this holographic drug has the same impact as the conventional aspirin without side effects and overdose. And aspirin is widely used for its ability of thinning the blood. And unfortunately, it has side effects. And some people simply, after some time, they can't use the aspirin. So this aspirin actually gives the people possibility to have the same benefits as conventional aspirin without the side effects and or danger of overdose. And the second preparation, the second holographic drug that my company has developed and verified is the embryo, is holographic embryo. So I literally have thrown a challenge to George Church at Harvard University with his synthetic embryo. And I consider that any damage that George Church would definitely do together with Jennifer Doudna can be corrected by embryo, the hologram of human embryo that my company has produced. And we have produced the digitized biohologram of the embryonic stem cell. And embryonic stem cell is the most valuable biological information on the market. And the sense is that we literally continue living because we get naturally rejuvenated by stem cells. So cells die and new cells are created by this process. And the stem cells are either somatic or embryonic, and they're different because we have specific already programmed stem cells in specific organs like liver or kidney, or we have embryonic stem cells that can be programmed into any cell in the body, and they are produced only in the embryo. That's why murder, global mass murder of embryos is conducted for this very precious biological material. And one of the reasons of why my company has produced holographic embryonic stem cell is to stop the global mass murder of embryos, which I consider to be a karmic crime. So we don't have to kill embryos. We can and should simply record a digitized biohologram of the embryonic stem cell and use it in the protocols of quantum leap genetic engineering via the holonet. We can even do it remotely at a close range via this chip that we are wearing, and remotely at long range via laser signal. And we conducted these experiments as well, and they have produced positive, successful results. And the sense of this production is that we have to literally create protocols for people, survival protocols, because right now we are approaching the point when the destruction would accumulate to such a degree that we might lose this keys, you see, to this portal to the other dimension. You see, we'll be locked in this dimension. So I even predict that the most horrible danger of all this genetic collapse is that people would not be allowed to die. So they try to sell us the dream of immortality, right? So we would be immortal, we would not have suffering, right? So like eternal hedonistic bliss, right? But in fact, we are already immortal. We are already uncreated and indestructible. So the danger lies not in inability to acquire digital immortality, but danger vice versa lies in the situation when you will not be allowed to die. You will be artificially held in this dimension. So we need to preserve this keys, right? The structural codes, reflection codes that we can escape.
Have you been inside a large Kozarev mirror yourself?
Huh?
Have you been inside a Kozarev mirror yourself?
Well, I have a few Kozarev mirrors. I will show you. Just hold on. You see, the Kozarev mirror that is constructed in Novosibirsk by Kaznacheyev, who died recently, and Trofimov, is not, it is called Kozarev mirror, right? They call it Kozarev mirror, but it's not Kozarev mirror, unfortunately. So this actually Kozarev, so-called Kozarev mirror, is actually an evidence that they don't understand what it is. They took the sheets of aluminum and just folded it like this. And inside they put an operator, and they put upon his head a pot, which is a rectangular pot. So they don't know anything about nucleus and these ancient laws, unfortunately. And that's why the experiments produced very negative results. People who participated, they got into some automobile accidents, road accidents, and they reported also kind of losing focus, like getting to some kind of dimensions, getting lost in these dimensions. So this is precisely because in this structure, the focus was not there. It was somewhere else. So these people were literally lost in time and space. And that's why I consider that nobody yet created proper Kozarev mirror. Even the mirror that Aura generated, that is in our clinic, I consider should be embellished. And I am intending to build another one. So there is a better version in Mias, in Urals, which is precisely egg-shaped, totally closed shape, with the top like our helmets of our ancestors, and they don't report any negative results. So this is a more proper shape, but they don't use any digitized holograms, any kind of intense signals inside. So it's a kind of preparatory shape of the Kozarev mirror. And now Aura generator, it's open in some sections, which are considered to be not precisely correct. So I'm intending to build another one with a better design, which is my plans. And I will show you Kozarev mirrors. So recently I put veneers, and they took out my crowns from my implants, and they put formatting stick, how would they call it, I don't know, into my jaw, and it was horrible pain. So which was driven me to tears. I'm a really seasoned warrior, but it was horrible pain. So I came home and I know and research the use of bells as therapeutics. And I have bells, right? Which is a quartz crystal. It's a Russian production. So I used this for 10 minutes and the pain was away. It was unbelievable. Okay. It's unbelievable. So these are proper Kozarev mirror. And our ancestors, they used bells to ward off infection. So Europe was literally depopulated by Black Plague. But Russians, every time Black Plague was approaching Russia, Russians were ringing the bells. And in the bell, first of all, there is the was field created, electromagnetic field around the belts. There are many of them. They are covered the vast territory with the belts. In Russia was 40,000 churches with belts before revolution. And in the pyramidal part, the signal is amplified, and in the spherical part, it is nullified. And the waveforms of bacteria and viruses, they get into the belt, the driver collected by this field into the belt, and it's they are nullified literally in the belt. And in 1965, Russian Soviet communists had experiments in the Kalinin district of Moscow. They researched hospitals, maternal wards, and Russian Orthodox churches, and they found out that maternal wards are so infected with staphylococcus and streptococcus that it is almost impossible to clean, to disinfect them. And Russian Orthodox churches are completely clean, though crowds of very sick people are daily going into the church. And this is precisely because of this principle. And Russian Orthodox churches, they use this principle in every aspect of the building, the ritual. They use the bells, the cupola ceilings, they use the cupolas. They use even the special parts, vessels in the walls. So this whole structure is actually healing structure. And the other one I have, this one. And this is from Himalayas. And you can actually use use the stick with this thing. And I have been in India, and I have just returned from India. I would like to show you something. So I bought this crystal quartz beads, right? And this is not jewelry. This is the sacred Brahman beads that they're wearing around the neck. And I bought them, and in a few ashrams they were jealous how beautiful they are. Brahmins. So the sense of these beads is that it is a simple structure of capacitor, or Russians call it condenser. So they have silver, this is silver. They put quartz crystal beads upon the silver wiring. So silver wiring has the electrical current, and crystal beads function as electrodes, stopping this current. And you get electrical charges on both sides of each bead. And this functions as condenser capacity, meaning that it collects electrical energy. So it literally collects energy for you. And I was doing yoga in India, and because I'm busy, I don't do yoga right now that intense as before. So I stretched a little bit my back. So I bought these beads, and it took me literally half an hour or an hour to get rid of the pain. Amazing. It's unbelievable. So I bought three kinds of big ones, and bigger and smaller. So so these are all ancient, our ancestral technologies. And our mothers conducted genetic engineering based upon sacred geometry, upon the generator form, as it's called in Russia. And they conducted genetic engineering of the tamed animals. So we have the same gene expressed in the wild horse, the so-called Przewalski horse, which is like a donkey. It is small, ugly, it cannot run for long distances. We have the same gene expressed by the acrocentric chromosome. And in the domesticated horse, it is expressed by metacentric chromosome. So the horse is strong, it's beautiful, it's proportionate. So they conducted their genetic experiment because they placed this animal, so I claim, it's my claim, my scientific claim, hypothesis supported by clinical trials. So I claim that our ancestral mothers, matriarchs, babas, they were able to tame the animals, literally changing the shape of their chromosomes while putting them into the environment like this. You see? They didn't do RNA interference and all this messing up with the sacred things. They were simply changing the shape of the environment and treating these animals with the attention and care, which provided the prolongated continuous signal, you know, this psychophysical signal. So the shape should be combined like a North Pole. 6 months, the day of the gods, continuous signal in the shape. And you can do successful genetic engineering. But for doing this successfully, you need to have the template to continuous humans, continuous matrix points. And for this, we need to record the holograms of children that are still intact. They are still not destroyed by vaccination, by genetically modified food, by microwaving food, which is very dangerous, no microwave, no reverse osmosis in food, and etc., and etc. And our large size generator, or as I said, it's the paradigm of the causative mirror. But I'm preparing the next generation of aura.
Thank you.
So?
I think so, yes. Thank you very much.
Okay, so this, by the way, I would love to actually sell this thing also. I founded the Skiffian Museum, you know? You know Skiffian Museum? I found